out there.
Wally is curious. He's optimistic and sunny and just appreciates things, and he's always looking for connection. Right now, his curiosity is getting him into trouble. But throughout the film, it's going to be his and everybody else's saving grace. When it comes to curiosity, it needs to be tempered with wisdom and experience. And Wally lacks both at this moment. And that is all. Thematically and in our own lives, curiosity is contagious. And what I love about the story of Wally is his curiosity passes to Eve, passes to the captain, passes to John and Mary, and everyone engages with life more fully when they stop just being complacent and just accepting things.
I didn't know we had a pool.
Computer, divine dancing.
We find solutions and we enjoy and appreciate more if we open our eyes with curiosity. It literally helps everybody to live and to experience things. That's the theme. We die when we get complacent, and we come back to life when we start being interested.
Hello and welcome to Cinema Therapy. I am Alan Seawright, a professional filmmaker who needs...
a therapy, and I'm Jonathan Decker, licensed therapist who loves...
movies!
What are we doing today? What's going on?
I don't know, we're doing a fun little intro.
No,
thing.
I know, but new. What are we watching?
Oh, we're gonna watch Wall-E!
Ooh! Ooh!
Have you seen this film?
I love...
It's a very good film made by Pixar.
Don't insult me.
It's about a robot who falls in love with another robot.
Sounds hot.
Real, real kinky.
You shut up! I'm so scared right now, you shut up!
What are we looking at in Wall-E?
Well, Wall-E is a very a curious young man. When I say young, he's 700 years old. I don't know why. He's not a man, he's a robot. Wall-E is a curious robot, and the people on board the Axiom,
yes,
not curious, the opposite. They're complacent.
Okay.
So we're going to do a little compare contrast, see how Wall-E helps the humans.
You did it. I'll take it from here.
My God, pull yourself together!
From now on, it's just my hair.
just.
He's gonna be doing everything, and I'm just gonna be doing this.
Just sit there and look pretty, okay? That's why you're here. Okay, let's go.
Hold on to your butts.
Okay. So this movie opens with a 9-minute long, wordless sequence of this adorable trash compactor.
Yeah.
Cruising around, like telling us everything we need to know about the world. This is a masterclass in filmmaking craft.
Yeah. When people say I couldn't get into it because it was a love story between robots, I'm like, shut up. You don't know anything about life.
Wow. Wow. And he's a therapist.
He does the hat thing that they're doing.
He's such a curious little boy. Pixar are great, obviously, duh. They made a 10-minute long sequence with nobody talking.
Yeah.
Nobody, no people.
Yeah.
Aside from one little bit of Fred Willard, live-action Fred Willard popping up somehow
for
in
some
the middle
reason,
of this
yeah.
animated movie. It's because like, well, why would we animate Fred Willard? He's already Fred Willard.
He's already perfect.
Yeah. Anyway, a weird little robot that's a trash compactor. And it was super compelling, fun to watch, funny, and told you everything you need to know about the world.
Well, and I love when movies give me new emotion combinations that I'm not used to.
Mm-hmm.
And this one combines charming with haunting.
Ooh, chaunting.
Don't talk, just... Because Wall-E is optimistic and sunny and happy and just appreciates things. And he's curious.
Yeah.
As he goes through the trash of Earth, he's like all the other Wall-Es are broken down.
On this dead planet.
On this dead planet. And he just finds all these things on the planet endlessly fascinating.
Mm-hmm.
And that is the source of his joy. Because he's alone, but he's just like, hey, this is cool. Like, I like to learn. And just learning feeds him. And so we adore him. And then it pulls back and the music is super somber, and we see like what we've done to the world.
Yep.
That we've just completely used up the resources, turned it into a giant garbage dump, and it makes me super uncomfortable.
Mm-hmm. This episode is sponsored by BetterHelp.
We know some of you have had concerns about BetterHelp in the past, but we've looked into this extensively and they are complying with the FTC.
BetterHelp connects you with a licensed therapist who's trained to listen and give helpful, unbiased advice.
Over 4 million people have used BetterHelp to start living a happier, healthier life.
BetterHelp has a network of over 30,000 therapists with a wide range of expertise.
And they're committed to helping you find a therapist who's a good fit for you.
You can easily switch to a new therapist at no additional cost if the first one you're matched with is not a good fit.
To get started, click the link below or go to betterhelp.com/cinematherapy and fill out the questionnaire to assess your specific needs.
Then you'll be matched with a therapist, in most cases in 48 hours or less.
You can choose a time that's convenient for you for your therapy sessions.
And you can also choose how you want to do your therapy sessions.
A phone call, a video chat, or even via messaging.
Even sitting in your hover chair looking at your holo screen while sipping a meal through a cup.
So if you think you might benefit from therapy, click the link below or go to betterhelp.com/cinematherapy.
You'll get 10% off your first month of BetterHelp so you can connect with a therapist and see if it helps you.
BetterHelp. Therapy in a cup.
That's not how that works.
How does the internet?
Not in a cup. This is...
It's such an ugly place, and yet you feel it's so beautiful. Boom! How he is just completely smitten with her is...
It's the most adorable and understandable thing ever, but it's just... It's so sweet and charming. And this score by Thomas Newman, come on.
And then the... Like the mushroom cloud is so far away! Eve is such a mood. But, you know, Wally is curious about her. And that feeds into, she is here on a mission. She's not here to appreciate or enjoy anything. She's here to do what she was programmed to do what she was sent to do. And he's going to unlock for her, to borrow from Aladdin, a whole new world, right?
Well, I'm going to push back on that. Because the second nanny robot leaves, what does she do?
Mm.
She's exploring her curiosity, which is, I can fly.
Yeah, that's true.
I can zip around and really enjoy myself. I'm going to get back to work, but first, I got to make a sonic boom.
Yeah, I'm not being babysat anymore. That's true.
Yeah.
Okay, that's a good pushback.
Yeah, and then I love that, you know, we see the blasted rock and we pan over to Wally and he's terrified.
Yeah.
And then what happens?
Well, and then he's not deterred by his fear. He might... tread more softly and
how can I be curious without getting blown apart?
Right. But this is the beginning of him learning from experience, and he doesn't let his curiosity get dampened or diminished. He just integrates, okay, how can I be smarter about it?
Yep.
It sounds like Who Are You, but it's not.
Yeah.
You know, but you still get it.
Such genius sound design. And then this glowing, beautiful reveal of her from the smoke.
It's like, well, she's already friends with the roach. So if the roach, she's like, okay, fine, he's not a threat. Does he have what I'm looking for? No.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Back to the mission. How many times did that exact thing happen to you where, like, you tried to hit on a girl, like when you were single, you tried to pick up a girl and she just sort of like from on high sort of scanned you and was like, not a threat.
Yeah.
And walked away and you were just like,
well, isn't that how you and Megan met?
That's exactly how we met.
You're not a
threat.
Her arm
didn't turn into a blaster. It can. It just didn't that time.
But she's like, okay, this guy's not a threat, but also meh, whatever. Yeah. And you're like,
and she literally walked away and I...
Yeah, I was gonna say, why are you putting this on me? This is your story right here.
That's valid.
I mean, you never did a gondola ride through a river of filth, but you know,
that you know of.
Okay. So that thing that you're good at until a girl's watching, right?
Uh-huh.
Chief directive. Classified.
Oh.
Wally.
And I love that they have her laughing.
Yeah.
Eve.
And then she laughs.
Eva.
She thinks he's cute.
He's cute as hell. This is, by the way, AI scientists and roboticists. This is what we all want. Give us a Wally, please.
I think it's so charming, and now we're starting to get into limited word use. We've had so long that it's all been nonverbal. But even then, they're wrestling for it, especially him.
Mm-hmm.
And I really like and appreciate that right out of the gate, you see that she's into it.
Yeah.
For her, she may not even have a concept of romance or anything, but she likes this guy.
Sure.
You know? And what's not to like? And
he's cute, he's earnest, he's charming, he can squish things into cubes.
So finally convinces her to go on a date of sorts, go back to his place.
Yeah.
And not only does she see all the stuff he's collected, but she has a curiosity that's awakened within her that she didn't even know was there.
Right, yeah.
As she starts to see this crummy dead planet through his eyes, and he sees the wonder in everything.
Everything is magnificent.
Yeah. And that expands her ability to live and to experience things. And that's part of why this is a beautiful love story. So when you're like, it's two robots falling in love, pay freaking attention. I'm mad at you, random internet patron.
Are you a patron of the internet? I'm just confused by this relationship.
You and me both, brother.
Okay. Let's see. You're supposed to be on a whole different planet.
Well, let's open her up.
I've definitely been that guy. Where I'm just seeing and hearing what I want to see and hear. Boy, you're real pretty.
This is where Hitch actually had some good advice. Listen to what she is saying to you.
Correct.
So they're on the Axiom now. And speaking of curiosity versus complacency, this is where the film really starts to open that up. Yep. I mean, planet Earth is destroyed and decimated and full of garbage because we got complacent and lazy and didn't seek solutions and just kind of let it keep piling up until time ran out. And then we had to go do something else. And then in space, we just kept doing what we were always doing, which is eating and watching shit. And not that there's anything wrong with eating and watching shit, but like, you got to live a life.
Right.
And instead, you get to this place where everything is provided for you, right? When you're so prosperous, and we see this throughout history, civilizations fall because they get so prosperous that they get complacent. And whereas innovation and growth are driven by curiosity, and the people on the Axiom...
Hey, take the cup! Please remain stationary. A service bot will be here to assist you momentarily.
Stuart! Hello?
Please remain stationary. A service bot will be here to assist you momentarily.
What's that? What's going on? John?
Well, this seems to be...
No. John.
This is a thing that's never happened to John.
Hi, Wally.
He's experiencing a new thing in his life. So same thing with Mary.
Mary?
Eva.
Oh, sure. Yeah,
I like that John and Mary are polite and decent.
Yep.
There's no criticizing them of as people. There's criticizing of the system that's led to this. But there's this whole, they have a pool. No one's using the pool. Right? Like, it's like going to the playground with your kids and all the parents are just staring at their phones.
Mm.
Which, I'm not saying never do that. Sometimes you need a break. But sometimes go out there and play with them. you know?
Sometimes go to a playground by yourself.
I didn't know we had a pool.
No, that's weird.
She's like, I didn't know we had a pool. But the commentary is razor sharp.
Yeah.
That all of these people are so immersed in a life of complacency. They're drinking their liquefied food. They're staring at their screens. There is no curiosity about how life works, what the world around them is like. There's no need to innovate. Everything's already solved.
Yeah.
And everything's just kind of meh. And Wally is shaking them loose and shaking them out of it. Both John and Mary have been shaken out of their complacency by his curiosity, and they're going to start to see the world around them and start to question, right, what's going on.
Yeah, I mean, he literally physically knocks John,
yeah,
you know, out of it, and he pulls Mary out of it by, like, popping her out of her little bubble. There's a physical action there, and there has to be a physical action because Wally is Buster Keaton.
Yeah. And he's always looking for connection.
That's true, huh? He introduces himself both times.
Yeah. Each time, the intention is he's trying to get help, and he's also trying to get to know somebody, and they have to get away from their phones, right, basically.
Yeah.
They have to get away from their phones and interact with the being who's actually in their presence.
Sure.
And man, that hits hard.
It's, in the middle of this
chase,
heist, spy thriller chase,
it's like, can we hold hands now? Is this the moment? And Eve is just always mission, gotta get the plant, gotta do.
Deliver to Axiom Superior.
Eva
takes a moment.
Ouch!
No, shh.
Directive.
Well, and she regrets this later on. Like, her heart is touched by what the Gottmans call bids for connection.
Oh, okay.
That when you are making a bid for connection, and does your partner respond to, or do they brush it aside?
Yeah.
And that's the thing about Eve, is she's got some curiosity now, but she's so mission-focused and mission-oriented and goal-oriented that she's rejecting Wally's bids for connection, which she later regrets. But it is really funny that Wally is also very singularly focused. His directive is now Eve. Is
hold hands.
Yeah, holding hands, like I saw in Hello Dolly, because that's the movie he's watching. And so he keeps trying to make it happen at the wrong time. And this is so graceful.
Well, and the score amplifies this so much.
Hey, that's what's his name?
Hey, what the?
Look at that.
What? Hey, I know that guy. It's, Wally. That's it. Hey, Wally.
Wally.
Hey, it's your buddy John. Hey.
Hi.
Hi.
Neither of them have really experienced human connection. I mean, in this world, they may have been raised by
robots and screens. Yeah.
Define hoedown.
Hoedown, a social gathering at which lively dancing would take place.
What on earth is amazing? These are called farms. Humans will put seeds in the ground, pour water on them, and they grow food like pizza.
I really want a pizza plant.
Psst, computer. Define dancing.
Dancing, a series of movements involving two partners where speed and rhythm match harmoniously with music.
So Wally's got Eve to not focus on the mission and just enjoy. I mean, she went out to rescue him, but now that they're out here.
Yeah. Okay. All right. I am crying because the joy is too powerful. Like, this is how, when my emotions are too big, this is how they get out.
Yeah.
And it's dumb and it's embarrassing.
It's neither dumb nor embarrassing.
You're not the guy crying at two robots dancing in space.
Okay.
Well, you've got me there.
Okay. I can be embarrassed whenever I feel like it. I'm not that embarrassed by it. I love this movie. That entire sequence is magical. Yeah. I'm in awe of it.
Thematically and in our own lives, curiosity is contagious. And as I was saying, there's no innovation, there's no growth. And not only in the sciences, but in our relationships. When we get complacent, things plateau or they backslide. Mm-hmm. And if we're not looking for new ways to connect, new solutions, and I'm not saying the old standbys, the traditions, the tried and trues in your life don't work. I'm saying when they're not, right? At what point do you stop being curious about your partner? You think you've got them figured out. You stop being curious about your kids. You think you've got them figured out. Instead of recognizing that every person is ever evolving.
Yes.
And that's endlessly fascinating. And we connect more with our world. Food tastes better. Our senses are more stimulated when we're curious and when we're attuned to them. This is what mindfulness is, by the way. It's being present in the moment and being aware and being curious and asking questions. And there is a psychological toll, especially for those of us who live in first world countries. There is a psychological toll of things if things are too easy.
Sure.
And if everything's just kind of there, we don't ask how the sausage gets made, and we probably should. And we find solutions and we enjoy and appreciate more if we open our eyes with curiosity. And what I love about the story of Wally is his curiosity passes to Eve, passes to the captain, passes to John and Mary, and all of them engage
through
with them life.
Passes to the whole ship, right?
And everyone engages with life more fully when they stop just being complacent and just accepting things.
Yeah. And Wally learned all of it from a cockroach.
Wait a minute.
So she's watching Wally's security footage from his own. And she realizes this is what Wally was trying to do the whole time.
Eva.
And he puts his little wheels back.
Oh my gosh. The animators at Pixar are so damn good. It's upsetting. If anyone at Pixar is watching this, you are better at animating than I am at anything. And I love you and hate you for it. Good job.
This film is such a powerful example of how you can do so much with so little.
Yes.
And I mean, you could talk about that artistically, but I look at this as how many times do we use a lot of words when we don't need many?
Always.
Have you watched
our show?
So me think, why waste time? Say lot word when few word do trick.
Mo the germaphobe.
Mo. 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 Mo.
I love that Mo's a germaphobe and he's super uptight.
Yeah.
And we love him for it.
It's so fitting. It's what he's programmed to do.
Yeah.
Camera moves to show her perspective shift.
Directive.
You.
Oh.
Gosh.
And. Nope.
But they let it breathe long enough to still have that emotional beat.
Yeah.
Earth.
All the stuff to fix me is back on Earth, and the plant gets us back there.
Yep.
And I'm saying it, but the movie tells you.
Movie tells you. You don't need to be told that.
The reason I'm pointing out is not because people don't get it.
It's because it's phenomenal storytelling.
It's to point out, like, the film tells you without telling you, and it's, and kids get it.
Everyone gets it.
Yeah.
Everyone gets it. I don't get it. How did you do it? Tell me how you did it. I want to be like you.
Please. I want to sleep again. I want to know.
I want to know.
Damn it. I need to know, and I need to know now.
This is where it goes from for Wally and Eve. She thinks he's cute and sweet.
Yeah.
And we think the whole movie that he's in love with her. He's actually not. Not how I define it. He's infatuated with her.
Sure.
This is where it becomes love.
Yeah.
Because what matters to him is her directive. And also, this is how we get back and save me. And what matters to her is he matters.
Like, my directive doesn't matter. My new directive is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That is, oh. This is what's wild to me, and I'll cut the, oh, it's a love story between two robots people a little bit of slack. Mm. I understand that on paper, that sounds ridiculous and kind of stupid. And yet, I kid you not, I think this is one of the most beautiful love stories I've ever seen on film.
This is in my top 10 in all-time films. It is one of the best films ever made. It's in the Criterion Collection. There's a reason.
Troll 2, one day.
Perfection.
Wally!
No!
Oof. And I love how they planted that seed with so many jokes, and now it matters to the story.
Now it pays off.
Plant origin verified. Course set for Earth. 10 seconds to hyper jump. 9, 8.
Wally!
7, 6. Uh-oh. 5.
Oh no.
4.
Well, now I'm crying.
3.
Yep.
2. 1.
Oh, shut 0. Up! Come on! This new system is not working for me. It's so brutal and mean.
I just put a little card that says end, and it broke Jono. Well, there's no more curiosity.
Wally's dead. So Hope is dead.
Damn you, Pixar. I am crying because a robot died.
Well, something that I love is when they get back to Earth, how amazingly, blindingly fast and furious Eve is, like, tearing through everything.
She just, like, rips through everything, jacks him back up and fixes him and puts all the parts
and then
up.
Blows the roof off, you know. And even at her sweetest, she's still a badass.
Yeah, totally.
And the ending is very, very touching. But what's so powerful to me about this story is what I've already said. Like, the curiosity is contagious.
Mm-hmm.
And it literally helps everybody come back to life, including the planet.
Yeah.
Like, I think that's the theme, is that we kind of die when we get complacent, and we come back to life when we start being interested. So until next time.
Directive?
And
watch movies.
Yes, what he said. I had no warning. They attacked at dawn. We had no warning.
We had no warning.
Patreon, it's your superstore.
We got director's cuts.
And lots of other cool stuff. We got some sketch comedy stuff that we're doing now.
All kinds
of behind
crazy.
The scenes, outtakes, all sorts of amazing content.
Therapy deep dives?
Yes, therapy deep dives, filmmaking deep dives. So we want to thank our patrons for supporting this channel. People like
Tara the Lioness,
Dan D. Lion.
Lots of lions going on. Mike and Patty Ferry.
Brianna.
And Gray.
Thank you for contributing to our ongoing corpulence.
Thanks to all our patrons, we'd like to give you a Septuagintennial cupcake in a cup.
But we won't.
Disappointment!